First of all, thanks a lot for the invitation to speak here. My talk is going to be a little more general than the previous two, and I hope to stir up a few more controversies. So, now, you see, if you have a title with a question mark, you know that either the answer will be no, or the answer will be in some respect yes, in some respect no. So the answer is definitely not going to be a clear yes. So that you already know by just looking at the question mark in the back of the title. Now, here you see that I have quite a long list of things that I would like to address. So I'm going to start by reminding you of the magnitude of the fine-tuning problems which standard Big Bang cosmology suffers from. And then I'll put the inflationary cosmology in the context of these fine-tuning problems, and at that point it will look very nice for inflation. But then I will talk about some problems which I see in inflation, and that is related to some of the questions that came up in the previous two talks. Now, if there are problems in inflation, there better be some alternatives to which we can compare inflation. So if I have time, I'll also talk a little bit about alternatives. Okay, so the inflationary scenario has become the paradigm of all universe cosmology. So if you go to astronomy talks these days, you hear people say, the universe began with a big bang, after that there was a period of inflation, and so on, as if this was established. Well, why do people start their talks like this? Inflation definitely explains some mysteries of standard Big Bang cosmology. For example, it explains the fact that in all directions in the sky, the microwave background temperature is the same. So this is a projection of the sky onto a plane, different colors, different intensities, in different temperatures, and this is the isotropy. Okay, so this is the horizon problem. Now, standard Big Bang cosmology does not explain why the universe is spatially flat to the extent that we can measure. And it also doesn't explain why the universe is so much bigger than the Planck size as we observe it. So these are three mysteries which inflation explains. But more importantly, for current astronomy, inflation was very successful because it provides a causal theory for the origin of cosmological fluctuations and isotropies in the microwave background distribution of galaxies. So we now have these beautiful maps of the small amplitude deviations of the temperature of the microwave background from being isotropic. So this Jerome already showed. These relative temperature fluctuations are 1 part in 10 to the minus 5. You can quantify them. And this is the power spectrum of these fluctuations, large angular scales, small angular scales, the data, some statistical error bars, some systematic uncertainties, and there's a red curve that fits the data remarkably well. This red curve is predicted by inflation, except for the overall amplitude. So, inflation predicted a scale invariant spectrum of cosmological perturbations with a slight red tilt, which means slightly more power on long wavelengths than on short wavelengths. It predicted that the fluctuations are nearly Gaussian. It predicted that the fluctuations are nearly adiabatic. And it makes further predictions which haven't yet been confirmed, namely the near scale invariance of gravitational waves and a slight red tilt in the spectrum of gravitational waves. So these predictions were made shortly after 1980, and the high quality data came in 2000 something. So inflation was really predictive. And I think from a historical point of view, absolutely no one can argue with the fact that inflation is a very successful predictive theory. Okay. However, if you read papers on the archive now, opinions on inflation differ greatly. Opinions by people who participated in the development of inflationary cosmology. So this is a quote from André Linde. Inflationary theory has gradually become a broadly accepted cosmological paradigm, with many of its predictions being confirmed by observational data. Okay, Guth, Kaiser, and Nomura write, inflation makes specific quantitative predictions for several observable quantities that match the latest observations to a very good precision. And therefore, cosmic inflation is on a stronger footing than ever before. On the other hand, Paul Steinhardt, also one of the key contributors to models of inflation early on, and Anna Ijas and Avi Loeb, they write, in sum, we find that recent experimental data, the Planck results, disfavor the best motivated inflationary scenarios and introduce new serious difficulties that cut into the core of the inflationary paradigm. This sounds black and white compared to the previous. Okay, now there's something else here. What do they mean precisely? They talk about an initial condition problem for inflation. They talk about something which they call the multiverse unpredictability problem. And they talk about an inflationary unlikeliness problem. Okay, so I'm going to address some of these issues in the talk. Now, Mukhanov was actually the first person to have computed the spectrum of cosmological perturbations, including a red pill. He steps back a little bit and he says, the multiverse and eternal inflation damage the predictive power of the theory because of what you can read. But then he says, the recent CMB observations have unambiguously proven the theory of the quantum origin of the structure in the universe, independent of what gives the background. And since he calculated that, he claims that therefore he deserves a Nobel Prize for this, because he computed the red pill. Okay, so now I'm not going to leave you hanging until the end of the talk. I will argue that in the case of large field models, the inflationary slow roll trajectory is a local attractor in initial condition space, including in homogeneities, and you already heard about this in the previous talk. I will argue that the multiverse issue is irrelevant for inflationary cosmology. However, there is some tuning of initial curvature which is required to get inflation. There is a slight hierarchy problem if you want to obtain the right magnitude of the cosmological perturbations. I'm willing to live with this hierarchy problem, by the way. But I think that inflation has some conceptual problems which I'll describe, and that therefore we cannot right now accept inflation as a good theory. It might be a good toy model, but not a good theory. So these are the this is the message that I want you to walk away after this talk. So let me step back. The fine-tuning problems of standard Big Bang cosmology, the isotropy of the microwave background. What type of problem is that? So the microwave background is released about 100,000 years after the Big Bang, the surface of last scattering. And in standard Big Bang cosmology, the zone of causal influence only extends to about 1 degree in the sky, as opposed to 180 degrees in the sky. So in standard Big Bang cosmology, we might be able to explain the fact that the temperature is the same over this region, but never over this region. So there are roughly 10 to the 9 patches of the current's space projected onto two dimensions that we need to explain. So we are talking about a fine-tuning problem, one part in 10 to the 9. Okay, what about the spatial flatness? So let us assume that initial conditions are set at a time when the temperature of the universe was 10 to the 16 GeV, which is a couple of orders of magnitude lower than the Planck scale. It's the scale of particle physics ground unification. So the, okay, let me go down to the back. So if we use a metric of space-time given by this scale factor, then the energy density in spatial curvature decreases as scale factor to the minus 2, but the energy density in radiation, which dominates for most of the evolution of the universe, goes as 8 to the minus 4. And therefore, if you want the energy density in spatial curvature to be not more than, not dominant today, you need it to be fine-tuned to this accuracy at this initial time. So a very serious fine-tuning problem. Now, standard Big Bang cosmology cannot explain the origin of structure in the universe in a causal way. This I indicate in this space-time diagram, time and space. Here I work in co-moving coordinates. So if you imagine the universe as an expanding balloon, these co-moving coordinates are the coordinates which are painted onto the surface of the expanding balloon. And so I fixed a wavelength. So you visualize this as an oscillation on the surface of this expanding balloon. It has constant co-moving coordinate. We want to compare this with the horizon. And at the time of equal matter and radiation, the wavelength is already bigger than the horizon. And if you go all the way back to the time of ground unification as initial time, then you find that the wavelength of scales that we observe today is 10 to the 19 times the horizon at that time. So you have a 10 to the 19 obstacle in standard Big Bang cosmology for having a causal structure formation mechanism. So these are serious fine-tuning problems, and inflation solves these right away. So inflation is the idea that the timeline of Big Bang cosmology, Big Bang, we are here, that the timeline is modified slightly by introducing a period of exponential expansion, or almost exponential expansion of space. So inflation begins at some time, it ends at some time. So this is the corresponding space-time diagram, time and space. This is physical distance. And first of all, I plot the horizon, which is the region of causal contact, beginning at one point. This expands linearly in the pre-inflationary period. Since space expands exponentially, the horizon expands exponentially. So that's this line. So compared to standard Big Bang cosmology, the horizon is exponentially larger. So let's look at this line. This line is the Hubble radius, which is the inverse expansion rate of space. And the Hubble radius distinguishes scales where microphysics dominates from scales where gravity dominates. So if you want to produce fluctuations by some microphysical mechanism, let's imagine the early universe as a soup and the generation of perturbations, let's imagine this as a demon stirring the soup, then the demon is constrained by microscopic equations of motion to only be able to produce waves with wavelengths smaller than a Hubble radius. So what happens in inflation? The demon is stirring the soup, producing waves. Since space expands exponentially, the wavelength of these waves expands exponentially. So this is this red curve. It is the wavelength of fluctuations which the demon is producing in this exponentially expanding universe. The name of this demon is quantum vacuum fluctuations. So, okay, good. So this is the space-time diagram of inflation. So since the horizon is exponentially larger than without inflation, you've explained the horizon problem. No, it's very easy to establish the same state of matter in regions much larger than those that we have access to with the microwave background. We have a mechanism that causally produces fluctuations. So, okay, good. So here's a statement. If the period of inflation is sufficiently long, then the horizon at the onset of inflation is blown up to be larger than the observed universe. So the causality region is sufficiently large to establish causal contact at uniform temperature. So If you work in the context of Einstein's theory of general relativity, in order to get inflation, you require some kind of matter with constant energy density. Well, relative to constant energy density, the energy density in spatial curvature decreases very fast. And so therefore, even if at the beginning of inflation you start out with significant spatial curvature, this spatial curvature will decrease exponentially, and it will become completely negligible at the end of inflation. And here is the quantitative statement. Okay, so inflation can solve the fine-tuning problems of standard Big Bang cosmology. Okay, so what do you need to get inflation? So if you work in the context of general relativity, then we need scalar field matter to get inflation. So, why? So inflation is a phase with exponentially growing scale factor. This requires matter with an equation of state pressure almost equal to minus energy density. So the usual matter fields cannot give that. Therefore, you need a scalar field. The potential energy of a scalar field has this equation of state, but you need the scalar field to dominate the energy density. No kinetic energy density, no tension energy density, and therefore you need the scalar field to be slowly rolling. You need to be slowly rolling such that potential energy dominates and that you get inflation. Okay, so now the statement that I'll talk about a little bit later is that you need field values bigger than the Planck mass or fine tuning in order to get slow roll inflation. And this is something that was already alluded to in Jerome's talk, and I'll show some graphs on that. Okay, so this is how you get inflation. So now let's come back to the objections against inflation. So, initial conditions, multiverse, and then the statement that inflation is not predictive. So I'll talk about these three issues. So, first of all, initial conditions. And as Jerome already emphasized, we have to distinguish between small field inflation models, where the idea is that you start out at the top of a potential like this and roll down, and this field value is much smaller than the Planck mass. This is a typical Higgs potential for the standard Higgs field. Okay, so if we now look at the phase space of evolution in this model, so field value and its momentum, field momentum, this is the bottom of the two bottoms of the potential, then the slow roll region is this region here, where you're slowly rolling. Slow means pi almost equal to zero. This is a slow roll trajectory. Now, in phase space, this is not an attractor. If you start here, you move away. You don't move towards it. So you see, slow roll, small field inflation, the inflationary trajectory is not an attractor in initial condition space. And as Goldratt and Piran studied in detail in approximately 1990, there is an initial condition problem for those models. However, for large field inflation models, where you assume that the scalar field resides here initially, and it comes down slowly rolling because of the gravitational friction, the phase space diagram looks very different. And this we already saw in the previous talk. So this is again field value. This is field velocity, momentum. This is the slow roll trajectory if you start from very large positive field values. This is the slow roll trajectory if you start from very large negative field values. And if you start rolling up the potential, then you'll obviously turn around and approach the slow roll trajectory. So as long as you have a field range of greater than n Planck to operate in, then you have an attractor. Now, this is what I've shown you here is just at the phase space at the homogeneous level. Now you can include inhomogeneities into this study, So let's start out the scalar field with lots of wiggles, different wavelengths, but some zero mold, which is offset like this. Then, and you dump most of the energy into the fluctuations, but you keep a little bit of the energy in the zero mold. The universe will be expanding because there's energy. The inhomogeneous modes will redshift away. The zero mode will maintain. And so therefore, this slow roll trajectory is a tractor, even including small amplitude inhomogeneities. And you can even include small amplitude gravitational fluctuations. You find that this is still an attractor. So large field inflation is a local attractor in initial condition space. And you see this work was done a long time ago. So in particular, no homogeneity over Hubble scale is required. As I said, you can easily start with initial conditions where most of the energy is in inhomogeneities. And you can even include small amplitude gravitational perturbations. And recently, this problem has been addressed for full numerical relativity codes. There are two independent collaborations. One is William East and his collaborators. The other one is Eugene Lim at King's College and his collaborators. And they basically agree with these conclusions. So bottom line is, in terms of initial conditions, large field inflation is actually in very good shape. So let's now, and I think this is not something that I expect a lot of controversy on. Now the next issue is the string inflationary multiverse issue. And here what I'm going to say is going to be much more controversial, and I expect quite a bit of disagreement. But let me say that what I'm going to say is exactly the same thing that Slava Mukhanov, a great defender of inflation, would say. So what is the string inflation and multiverse issue? Well, it says that there's a multitude of ground states of string theory, and that there is something called stochastic eternal inflation, not just simple classical inflation, but stochastic effects in inflation, they will populate all of these string vacua. And so therefore, we can't know which vacuum we'll end up in, and therefore this is a big problem for the predictability. So this is the claim. And André Linde would completely agree with this, with these ingredients. Okay, now what Slava Mukhanov has said in print, and which I say here, is the following. Stochastic effects are important only for field values which are many orders of magnitude larger than the Planck mass. So what are stochastic effects? So again, we saw potentials. Imagine a ball rolling in the potential. Stochastic effects are little quantum fluctuations which make the ball roll up the potential in half of the cases, down the potential in the other half of the cases. And they compete against the classical force. But quantum effects are very small in amplitude. So you need these very, very large field values such that the quantum effects become large. So this is far in the transplanting sea of ignorance. In an inflationary model, all the scales that we observe today have exited the Hubble radius at field values comparable to M Planck, maybe between 1/10 M Planck and 10 M Planck, orders of magnitude from this regime. So there is one question which we are going to come back to, is whether we have physics under control even for these field values. But there's no way that we have physics under control for these values. So What I'm saying is that this multiverse issue is not an issue for inflation as a theory of cosmology. Because as a theory of cosmology, we are dealing with these field values. We're dealing with a patch of the universe where the field values is about this, and then we want to see what happens. So simply, cosmologists do not have to bother with the multiverse picture. So there's the other input. So this was the stochastic eternal input. There's a string vacuum, multitude of string vacuum. So people say that string theory is completely ill-defined because there are these 10 to the 500 vacua, ground states. Well, these are pretty true. String theorists don't know non-predominative string theory. So talking about string vacuum does not make sense. We don't know what a vacuum of string theory is. In fact, there's a paper by Kum und Waffa and collaborators called The Swampland, where they show that most vacua of field theories motivated by string theory are not solutions of the string theory. Okay, so let me make a very strong claim, because I want to have the discussion, have a vibrant discussion. I will claim that the two basic inputs into the multiverse are completely inapplicable. So there's no issue. Okay, so when we talk about predictions, we have to look at the case.
Let me ask to understand your point clearly. So what's your point about string inflation then, if you don't have any vacuum, or you
okay, what is my view of string inflation? My view on string inflation, no one has produced a model of inflation which is consistently embedded in string theory. That implies in particular to the 2000 citation KKL MMT paper, that is not a solution of the higher dimensional equations, as you can read in a paper by Keshav Dasgupta and Roger Tatar and collaborators.
Okay. So that's your, there are other views, obviously.
Yes. I don't expect everyone, but I'm willing to defend this.
So where's Paul Stannard going wrong? He has realized the difference between the very large value of phi and moderately large value of phi.
Yes. Okay, so that question I don't need to answer. He's making an argument based on these inputs. Okay, and I claim that this is not the relevant argument to make. Okay, so let's come back to the predictability issue, because I'm going to go on to things that I see as problems in inflation. Okay, so let's look at the successes. So let's consider standard potential, just the simplest potential. Then in order to get the amplitude of perturbations right, we need this value of the mass. Okay, in this case, the stochastic regime is field values greater than M Planck over M to the 1/2 M Planck. This quantifies how far in the transplanting C the stochastic regime is. So therefore, I'm now going to consider a region which has undergone inflation and exited inflation. What about the predictability issue? Okay. Spatial flatness is predictive. We have a causal generation mechanism for cosmological fluctuations. It predicted a slight red tilt of the power spectrum. It predicted Gaussian fluctuations. There is little sensitivity on initial conditions, and the whole analysis is self-consistent as an effective field theory. So, the answer on the predictability issue is inflation is clearly very predictive. And let's look at this a little bit more carefully. It's not completely predictable, but very predictable. There are various observables. There's the amplitude of the cosmological fluctuations. There's the spectral tilt of the cosmological fluctuations. there are gravitational waves. There's a ratio between the amplitude of the gravitational waves and the amplitude of cosmological perturbations, which is usually called R. And there's a tilt of that spectrum. So these are sort of four standard observables. So any specific inflationary model predicts these. Because any specific inflationary model coupled in a consistent way to standard matter will give us what the reheating mechanism is and will also eliminate the ambiguity of reheating, which you discussed. But there are a huge number of inflationary models, as we heard in your talk. So inflation as an idea does not predict the specific values. So, and some of Paul's criticism is related to this. So simple inflationary models give a generic prediction that the spectrum is almost scale invariant, and both the spectrum of cosmological fluctuations and gravitational waves. Okay, so I find this a nice prediction. So even if you don't predict everything, if you predict some things, that's good. Now, obviously if you want to get the amplitude right, the amplitude of cosmological perturbations, then you need to stick in a particular value of parameters. For example, in this toy model, which I considered, a particular value of the mass. Okay, so, well, this might be a problem. It's not something I'm particularly worried about, because there are hierarchies in physics, there are different mass scales in physics. And the mass scale that has to be stuck in is not too different from the mass scale of ground unification. Okay. Which is what I'm saying here. So this is what I'm saying about the predictability issue. Okay, so at this point, I think I'm coming down very much on the line that inflation is doing very well. So hopefully you are getting this message. But I'm not finishing here, because I think that inflation has conceptual problems. And for example, it does not eliminate the initial singularity. There is a problem which Jerome and myself worked on, the transplantium problem for cosmological fluctuations, which I'll illustrate. I'm worried about applying generativity at energy scales of inflation. I would like to see the scalar field embedded in a consistent theory of all four forces. And I'm looking at you, because if indeed the scalar field, the inflaton, would come out naturally from string theory, I would be happy. So I would actually like to see the consistency with string theory. And I think that the mechanism of getting inflation, getting exponential expansion of space, suffers from us not understanding what solves the cosmological constant problem. I think it is perfectly possible that the mechanism which solves the cosmological constant problem will eliminate scalar field driven inflation as a possibility. That it will also make the potential which gives inflation gravitationally inert. So these are my conceptual problems with inflation. So here's a space-time diagram where I illustrate the transplantium problem. So you've seen this diagram before, time, space, the Hubble radius, the horizon. This is the physical wavelength of fluctuations we measure today. And if inflation lasts only a little bit longer, then the minimal amount of time that it has to, if it lasts for more than 70 Hubble expansion times, then even the larger scales that we observe today had a wavelength smaller than a Planck length at the beginning of inflation. And we definitely don't understand physics on these scales. And in doing the calculations of cosmological perturbations, we are using the usual physics on these scales where we cannot use it. So new physics must enter into the calculation of fluctuations. Okay, and I think everyone agrees with that. In particular, Andrei Linder and Slava Mukhanov agree with that. They have a paper in which they say this. It is not sufficient to show that the Hubble radius small, much smaller than the Planck scale, but you have to make sure that all frequencies that you talk about are smaller than the Planck mass in order to trust the analysis. So therefore, they are showing in this paper, they are showing that you cannot trust the calculations of fluctuations in inflation. Okay. Planck scale physics is testable with cosmological observations. So that's my worry. Now, inflation takes place unless you have fine-tuning of the parameters in the potential. It takes place at very high energy scales, at energy scales of about 10 to the 16 GeV. And to put that in perspective, the NHC scale is 10 to the 3 GeV, maybe 10 to the 4 GeV. The Planck scale is 10 to the 19 GeV. The string scale is 10 to the 17 GeV, based on the Bible of string theory of the 1980s, Green, Schwarz, and Witten. So the scale, energy scale where inflation works is very close to the string scale and quite close to the Planck scale. And at these scales, we know that general relativity is not even a good approximation. Not even a good approximation. Correction terms will dominate the dynamics. So therefore, I worry that the energy density at which inflation takes place is too close to the string scale and the Planck scale to trust any predictions made with general relativity.
So, would you say that inflation is impossible at lower scales?
I'm not saying that, but I'm saying that it is a conceptual problem. We have to show that inflation emerges, taking into account these other terms.
No, but I mean, if the scale was much lower than 10 to 16, you would avoid those problems.
Yeah, so if you fine-tune the potential, then you might be able to reduce the scale. But you see, we want to avoid fine-tunings. And you see, I was claiming that if you manage to have a successful model of inflation, if you forget about these Planck issues, string issues, things look very good. It looks like you can avoid fine-tuning. So I don't want to go your route. But you can certainly go. Okay.
But can I ask about the initial singularity? I mean, the de Sitter space doesn't have a singularity, right? And inflation is very close to de Sitter. So how does that play to you?
Inflation has a singularity in the past that can be shown at the same level as Penrose and Hawking. What you do is general relativity plus scalar field matter, you roll the clock backwards, you find an initial similarity. It is not vacuum and cosmological concept. It is very different. Okay. So, now, I would be very happy if you can show that inflation emerges from string theory or from some other ultraviolet complete theory. And in fact, effective field theory models moderated by superstring theory, in such models there are many scalar fields, many potential candidates for the inflation. However, the string effects are not under control for field values greater than M Planck. And also, the key principles of superstring theory are not reflected in string inflation models. So bottom line of this section is that I think that inflation suffers from conceptual problems, and so we can accept inflation as a non-fine-tuned toy model, but it is not yet a theory.
Are you making this statement for any potential? Because I think one has to distinguish between, say, if you look at the volume, for example, this can perfectly happily have larger values than the Planck, and the effectivity is completely unknown.
I'm making the statement about field values here. This field value statement. No, I'm making statements about the field value.
But if the field is the volume,
you need
of the gauge space, it can be much larger than Planck scale.
Yes, but those models are not under control.
Second.
Those models are not under control. I haven't seen a model in which large field inflation is under control. Now again, I don't expect people to agree with that, but I can give, and this again, I cannot.
I would say, for example, KKRT is perfectly under control.
No, I gave you the reference. I gave you a reference. It is not a solution of the high-dimensional equations of motion.
Okay.
As you can see...
So as 4D effective field theory, this has been understood.
As 4D effective field theory, it has been understood, but string theory is not a 4D effective field theory.
Yeah, but it's also not a 10D supergravity. It's a 10D string theory. And
yes?
These arguments that you give are based on 10D supergravity.
No, they're not.
As far as I know, yes.
No. They're based on M theory and string theory.
But it's not a tiny string theory calculation that these people do.
Okay.
We can talk later.
Yeah. Okay, so see here I'm touching on things which are controversial. And I did. I knew that they are controversial because I know that in Oxford people are working on string inflation models. Okay. How much time do I have? Do I have 5 minutes? Okay. Now, you see, if inflation were the only thing in town, we would have to embrace it because it was predictive. We would have to embrace it in spite of the fact that it might have some conceptual problems. But there are alternatives. Okay. Good. So first of all, when I showed you the angular power spectrum of cosmic microwave anisotropies, I said that this was predicted by inflation. Actually, it was predicted 10 years before in beautiful papers by Peebles and Yu and Zeldovich and Zunyaev. And this is a graph I stole from Zunyaev and Zeldovich's paper. This is time, this is space, this is the horizon, this is space in co-moving coordinates. This points out that if you have scale invariant fluctuations on super Hubble scales, they will enter the Hubble radius star to oscillate, and you'll see at recombination different modes at different phases of oscillation, and therefore you will get exactly this prediction. So this prediction, this red curve, was actually predicted 10 years before inflation. It was based on the hypothesis that there are fluctuations which are approximately scale invariant on super Hubble scales. And in the second part of this plot, these are the Baryon acoustic oscillations, so power spectrum of matter fluctuations as a function of wavelengths. So both the angular anisotropies of the CMB and the Baryon acoustic oscillation, the matter power spectrum, were predicted back in 1970. Okay, where does that leave inflation? Inflation is the first model to yield such a primordial spectrum from causal physics, but it is not the only one. Okay, so what does a model have to provide? It has to solve the problems of standard Big Bang cosmology, and it has to... It has to satisfy these three criteria. Okay, now I'm looking at the timer. So inflation satisfies all of these requirements. But there's another scenario that satisfies all of these requirements, namely a bouncing cosmology. Scale factor as a function of time, contracting phase, expanding phase, contracting phase, mirror inverse of the expanding phase. Space-time diagram. Hubble radius, this is a bounce point. Fluctuations start out on sub-Hubble scales, propagate on super-Hubble scales. Horizon is infinite. So in terms of addressing the criteria, this is an alternative to inflation for addressing all of the four criteria which a successful model has to address. Fluctuations which exit the Hubble radius in a matter-dominated phase of contraction acquire scale invariant spectrum. This is an alternative. Okay. Good. Another alternative is the ekparotic bounce scenario, where you assume that there's a bouncing cosmology, very asymmetric, very slow contraction, and then usual expansion. That also satisfies all four requirements, but to get a scale invariant spectrum of cosmological perturbations, you need to use an entropy mode. And finally, there's the emergent scenario, where you assume that there's a new physics phase. There might not even be a space-time here. It is some kind of thermal gas of strings, or something like that. Then there's a transition to the usual standard Big Bang phase of expansion. So, static phase, new physics phase, usual phase of standard Big Bang cosmology. Thermal fluctuations with holographic scaling give rise to cosmological fluctuations on all scales, you get a scheme done spectrum. So there are alternatives to inflation. But these alternatives all also suffer from problems. For example, the symmetric bouncing cosmology has an anisotropy problem. Very serious anisotropy problem. What physics gives the bounce? You don't solve the hierarchy problem. The ekpyrotic scenario, whole list of problems. What is the origin of this new field that gives rise to this very slow contraction? You need tuning of parameters to get the right amplitude. What is the origin of the bounce? Emergent scenario also has problems, flatness and size problem, although no transplanting problem. So the bottom line here is that alternatives to inflation exist, but they are also not without their problems. So, let me conclude. So I hope to have shown you that large field inflation is an attractor in initial condition space. So large field inflation doesn't solve for an initial condition problem. The multiverse issue is irrelevant for inflationary cosmology. There is some tuning needed to get the required amplitude of fluctuations. But inflation suffers from some conceptual problems. There are alternatives to inflation, and alternatives which address some of the conceptual problems of inflation, in particular the transplanting problem. But these alternatives have to date been incompletely developed, and they also suffer from some problems. But I have great hope that observations will tell. Because each of these alternatives is making slightly different predictions than inflation for future observations. So, thank you.